do with the snow day and all, because we've actually missed 2 days this term because of snow days. And I'm flexible, so if you do need extra time, you know, when you turn it in, just say, you know, hey, I need extra time. I have fallen way behind on my grading, by the way. My aim is to get stuff graded within a week of the original due date, and I'm not meeting that so far in this class. So I do apologize for that. Knock on whatever this is, I aim to get caught up over the next few days. In the meantime, if you have questions, let me know. Let's see. What are we going to do? Our next three big topics are some more CSS stuff. All right. They are that then some general design talk and principles. All right. And that kind of goes hand in hand with CSS stuff. And then talking about our project. So I don't know how far we'll get today on these, but over the next couple days, a couple classes rather, that's the stuff that we're going to go over. I'm going to bring down the example that we had last time. Now, I did have a student ask, and again, and I appreciate when students ask. If I assume that there's something that you know that you don't know, I'm glad when students ask me, you know, gee, how is it that you do that, or whatever. Because someone asked me, like, how to view the examples, because typically the examples are zipped up in a folder, a compressed folder or a zip file or whatever you want to call it. So I had a student ask me about that, and so what I want to do is I want to go over the process of, like, how you download an example and extract the files, and then how you'd be able to view them. All right? And then we'll pick up with the more CSS stuff from there. All right. I know, for example, that sometimes it's hard to read the screen in the videos. So that's why I supply the examples. All right. So if we go to someone left themselves logged in. Ooh, boy. I'm far more mature than to do something childish like that. Repeat that, please. Oh, okay. Fair enough. All right, so let's go to what we did last Thursday, I guess. So that would be week 4. The examples are posted the week that I do the lecture. All right, so here's a lecture for 2:13. You can click on that. You can see the video. Underneath it is the example. So you click on that, and notice it says .zip, which means it's a zip file. So I'm going to go and click on that, and it's going to save it on somewhere, probably my downloads folder, depending on how your machine is set up. Yeah, sure enough, there it is. Can bring that over to the desktop. Now, notice that there's like a little zipper on it. That means it's a zip file or compressed file. And if you open it up, you can see there's a folder inside of that. And there's files inside of there. But those files aren't really there as separate files. Everything is sort of smashed together into one file. All right? So you can't really open these up and work with them the way that you'd work with a regular file. You have to extract it first. So if you notice up here, there's a button that says Extract All Files. If you click that, it'll tell you where it's going to put it. And it's going to put it in, you know, some directory. And I can click Extract. And then it extracts those files. So notice now the folder that says Thursday, doesn't have the little zipper on it. It's opened up, which means that the files are actually in there and I can work with them and deal with them. All right. You, of course, do the opposite when you're going to turn it in. You take the folder like this, you right mouse on it, and you say send to compressed or zip folder, and that will actually create the zip folder, and that's what you upload to me. You have to upload everything in that's associated with your project. So all images, all CSS files, all web pages, you have to upload all of that. Alright, here's the example we did last time. And if you look at this, alright, I have a skiing page, and I have a second skiing page, second version of that same page, I guess. Alright. I'm going to go and change page 2 so that it looks different. So I'll go open it up in Notepad. And all I'll do is I'll just put page 2 on top of here. And I'll get rid of the image. So now we have two pages that are presumably about the same topic, but they look different. That one looks like this. That one looks like this. All right. It's sort of a design principle that you want pages on your site to have a consistent look. Now, consistent doesn't mean that every page needs to look or be structured identically. All right. Sometimes on your site there are pages that, for whatever reason, are a little bit different. And you might want them to be a little bit different, have a little bit different look or feel. But for the most part, you want pages to have a consistent look. That, if anything, that helps reaffirm to the user that they're still on the same page. You know, it can potentially be confusing for someone if you have pages that look way different from each other. Person's liable to think they somehow accidentally clicked and went to another site. All right, so you want a consistent look for your page. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply the same style sheet to both of these pages, and I'm going to put a link between the two pages. All right, so let me go and do that first off. So I'm going to go and I'm going to take and I'm going to copy the CSS from one file to the other. And I'm going to go with this CSS. And I like it a little bit better. So I'm going to copy it in there. And I'm going to add a navigation section to both of them. And I'm going to put both links on both pages. So I'm not going to get too elaborate here, but I'm going to put an unordered list, because that's really what a navigation is, an unordered list of links. Unordered because there's really no natural order for links. It's the way I think it's the best. So I'll put a link for this page, and then a link for that page. And I'll call it page 1. and I'll create a link for page 2. Now keep in mind that I'm doing this for just 2 pages, all right? But if you're going to add a 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th page, it's going to take the problems that I'm going to describe and just magnify it up from there, all right? So the more pages that you have, the bigger the potential issues are of keeping them consistent. All right, so there's the one page, there's the other, and I copied the CSS from one into the other. I'm going to copy the new navigation I put from one into the other, and I'm going to have the start of a mini site here, going here. Really what sort of we do at this point of the course is we sort of turn our attention from making simply individual web pages to making a larger site, you know, making a group of web pages together. So we're slowly moving in that direction. Let me make sure I save both of these and bring up in the browser, there's Ski 1, all right, page 1, page 2. I can go to page 2, go back to page 1, and there's some consistency with this, all right, they look the same. They have the same sort of look and all that. And that's a good thing, right? Well, that's a good thing until the boss of marketing comes by and says, you know, I don't like, what don't I like? I don't like, I want to reverse this. I want to make that white, the background white, I want to make the text blue. I don't like the white text on a blue background. So, okay. So what do? You go and you switch them, which is easy enough. I'll make color of the H1 that, and I'll make the background this. And I'll save it. Hit refresh. All right. Probably does look a little better, actually. All right. Except when I go to page 2, what's the problem that I run into? It's still wrong. All right. It's still the way it was originally. Why is that? Well, because I copied and pasted the style from one page to another. All right. What does that mean? That means that every time I would have to make a change, I would have to go into each page and make the change. And again, a typical website, even a small website, isn't going to have just 2 pages. It's going to have maybe a dozen pages, even a very small website. And larger sites could have more than that. So, a fundamental rule of any sort of software development, and I say this in every one of my classes, is D-R-Y, dry, all right? What does that mean? Does that mean don't spill coffee on your keyboard? Yes, it does, but more important than that, it means do not or don't repeat yourself. In other words, if you have something to change, ideally, you should be able to change it in one place and that change take effect everywhere on your site. Or if you're talking about like a Java program, change one thing and it takes place everything with everywhere within your program and so on. So that's what makes for a good program. The fact that it's easy to change. You know, a lot of times students will say, you know, well, what difference does it make? I got a page that looks good. What difference does it make? Why is this way better than that way? And the answer in software development is almost always one way is easier to change than the other way. The way that is easier to change is typically better than the way that's harder to change. That's one of the criteria for good software, is that it's easy to change. All right? So in this particular case, If I wanted to change the color of that header, I would have to make that change twice. Well, what's going to happen? What's going to happen, again, especially when we consider that I'm not going to have two pages, but I might have a dozen or 20 pages, I'm going to forget to do that in one page or a group of pages or whatever. And I'm going to have a site that looks inconsistent. Now, again, this particular thing isn't a world-ending problem, but for other issues, it can be magnified even more. So what we're going to do is, how could we make this easier to change? It would be nice if we had all my CSS code in one place, in one separate file, and then have every web page that I have simply point to that file. So I'm going to take the CSS code out of my HTML document. There's one of my HTML documents. There's one HTML document. Here's the other one. I'm going to take this style code out of it and put it in its own file. Then I'm going to tell both files, both HTML pages, to point to the CSS document. All right, so how do I do that? I'm going to create a new file. All right. Let me go and turn file extensions on because I want to know the precise names of these things. So I'm going to not hide extensions for known files. And I'm going to go and I'm going to take the CSS code out of the page and I'm going to put it in a separate file. When I do that, I no longer need the style tags. The fact that it's in its separate file is enough to tell the browser, hey, this is not HTML code, this is CSS code. So, all I'm taking into this is I'm not taking the style tags, I'm just taking the CSS rules. Alright? Then I'm going to go and I'm going to save this as a file. And to start, I'm going to put it in the same directory as the web pages. Kind of the same rules apply for this as what applied for images. It doesn't have to be in the same folder, but it's probably easiest to keep it in the same folder. And then later on, we can look about moving it around. So I'm going to go up here and I'm going to say, save. I'm going to put it in my Thursday folder. Save it as all files. And I'm going to give it a name, and I'm probably going to end it with a .css extension. You don't absolutely have to, but that's a good idea, because that's what it is. It's CSS. So I'm going to say style.css. And I'll save it in there. All right. So now, if I've done this right, I have in here my two HTML files and I have my style file. Now, what I need to do is I need to edit those HTML files because I've taken the CSS code out of one of them and I'm about to do it to the other one. I need to change that CSS code to point to that new CSS file I created. So let me go in here. All right, there's ski. Let me go and open the other one. I'll open ski too. All right. And I need to point these two files to my external CSS file. How do I do that? I do that with a link tag. Now, this link tag is different than like the kind of links where you link to go from one page to another. This length tag simply tells it, hey, use the CSS code that's in this file. Now, I have to set some attributes here. And rel equals style sheet. Don't ask me what rel means. I don't know. It means rel. All right? However, this is going to help identify to the browser that, hey, the stuff in here is CSS code. That's why we don't need that style tag anymore, because the browser knows this is CSS code. Type equals text slash CSS. And finally, href, which we've seen before. What do you suppose the href attribute is going to be? Yeah, it's going to be the name of the file that we're using. Right. So that's the hypertext reference. And I called my file style.css. It's in the same folder, so I don't need to put any folders before it and so on. Then I end the tag. Now let's go and save it. And there we go. It's back to using the correct style. Now let's go and I'm going to copy this line of code into my other page. I'm going to get rid of the style tag and I'm simply going to have that link to point it to use this file. So now both of them are saved. And notice now the two look the same. Now, if something changes, all I have to do is change that one CSS file, and both pages will be affected. Because now these two guys, I'm going to just close them, because I probably for the rest of the time, or most of the rest of the time, I'm going to be dealing with the CSS. So I can close those. Let's say I want the page to be green instead of blue. All right. I can go and edit my CSS file, and I can say, I want the body to have a background of green. Now when I bring it up, page 1 has a background of green, and page 2 has a background of green. So I only made the change in one place, yet both those files, since they no longer have their own CSS code inside of them, all right, since they no longer have their own CSS code inside of them, rather they point to that one CSS file in common, I only have to change that one. And this is true whether you have 2 or 200 HTML files. I can guarantee consistency between them simply by having all of them point to the one CSS file and then making a change to that CSS file. You'd have to put the link in all 200, but you do that as you're creating them. Later on, maybe next week, we'll talk about how you can essentially make a template for your web page, right? You want most of your pages to be consistent, and most of your pages are going to have the same sections and the same this and the same that, and are going to have some common code. So you're going to create a template, and in that template, you'll have the link to your style sheet, and then you'll essentially clone that template and then make the changes needed for the individual pages. In other words, to make 10 web pages isn't 10 times as hard as to make one web page, or doesn't take 10 times as long. All right, it takes a lot of time to make the first web page. Then it takes a little bit of time to clone it and make whatever changes you need to on that specific web page. All right. Okay. So I think we can clearly see the advantages of this. All right. One thing, if you notice, the links are blue, right? And that's kind of hard to read against that color. All right. Maybe we can make the links look different. All right. So, remember, your web page is always a combination of the rules that you've defined in your CSS and the rules the browser has. So, I have rules in here about what color stuff should be, yet in this particular case, the browser's default rules for links overrides. So, for me to make the links the color I want it to be, I can make them by putting in a style rule. Now, with links, as with any HTML tag, there are selectors and there is the style rule. So, in this particular case, if I want my link a certain color, my selector is going to be the A, right? Links are A tags. So, by putting in an A as a selector, I say any tag that's an A, I want to have this style rule. Now, I can play around with it, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to, for the links, I'm going to make the background white and the color black. Again, keep in mind some of the examples I do in class. I don't necessarily do them because I think they look nice. I do them because it will stand out when I'm displaying it. You know, you should do your best to make it look really good. In this case, I'm not recommending that this is a good idea. All right, so now I go and look at this and hit refresh, and there's my links. Black text and a white background. If I go to page one, black text and a white background. Notice this down here is also black text and a white background. Why is that? Well, because that's another link. So by simply putting in the selector of A, all right, it'll make every link on the page a certain color. All right. Questions about this? Yeah.
If I want to make an exception to CSS on an individual page for whatever reason, if I feel I need to, can I change that on the HTML file?
Great question. The question was if I want to make an exception on a particular page for whatever reason, which there's always a possibility for that. All right, what can you do? And you got a lot of options there. One thing you can do is you can actually have a second CSS file and put the second one underneath the first one, and then what you put in the second one will overrule. You could also do as you suggested and embed HTML code, or I'm sorry, embed CSS code in the HTML file. So like, for example, and again, this is just going to be an arbitrary example. Let's say on this page, I wanted the text to be yellow instead of white. All right. So, second page, I want the text to be yellow instead of white. If I were to change it in the CSS file, of course, then the text on both pages would be yellow. But what I could do is I could do this, and I could put underneath that style sheet, I could put a style tag The question is would it be better to embed it or create a second CSS file? I guess if you thought there might be more than one other page that you wanted to treat differently, then put it in a second CSS file. Then you can include both of them in all the pages that you wanted to be different. So like if 5 of your 20 pages you wanted some little oddball to look different for whatever reason, you could put a second CSS file then link to that also in those. If it was literally one page, then you could do it that way. All right. Yeah, go ahead. Okay, good question. Let's go and let's make sure we have code in here to actually test out what you asked. The question was, is what if I literally don't want all of my H1s to look a certain way, but I want some H1s to look one way, and I want some H1s to look another way? Again, lot of possibilities on how to deal with that. Let's go in and let's look at Ski 1. And here's an H1 that's sort of the banner of the page, the header. Let's put another H1 in here. It says downhill. All right, so now if we look at these, all right, to your point, that H1 looks like that H1. Now, I might want it to say that that top H1, which sort of serves a different purpose than the other H1, that's sort of like the title of the whole page. This is sort of like the title of this section. What if I wanted those to look different? Well, again, the answer I'm going to give, like probably to every one of these questions, is there's several ways to do it. All right, and then we can discuss what a good way is and how you might decide between the two ways. In this case, if you think about what you're saying, in a nutshell, you're saying the H1 in the header you want to look one way, the H1s in the section you want to look a different way. So what I can do when I define my CSS, I can enhance my selector to say header H1 looks this way. What that means is any H1 that is in the header section will get this style rule. I can then say any H1 that is in the section again, we're not going for good looks here. We're just going to stand out. I'm making the background red. So now, the H1s there in the header look that way, the H1s in the section. So, and what we're doing is we're refining the selector. Remember, the selector is the thing before the braces, before the curly brackets. And the selector defines what gets a particular style rule. All right? The first selectors that we've done in this class were simply HTML tags. Body tag gets this. H1 tag gets this. A tag gets this. But we can refine those selectors by saying H1's in the header. And that's exactly what this means. Within the header, an H1 will get this role. Within a section, an H1 gets that. Okay? Yeah, you do section H2. Or like, for example, let's see here. Let's say I wanted that link to look different. All right? Let's say that link I want, we'll make it different. Yeah, we'll make it yellow on the green background. I can say links in the nav section get that rule. Links in the footer section get this rule. Maybe that. All right. And then those links look one way, these links look another way. This is where, just as a side note, of anyone who did HTML development before HTML5. Before HTML5, you didn't have all those great tags like section and nav and header and so on and so forth. And everything was in a div, more than likely. You had a div that was your navigation, a div. In which case, you had to use a lot of IDs, which we'll come to, if not now, in a few minutes or next class. And the new tags just make it a lot more meaningful to do that. You can really specify the selector to a lot more precise way. And you'll end up using probably less IDs than you used to, simply because there's a nav section. So I don't have to say everything that's in an ID of nav, blah, blah, blah. All right. Now, do remember, I'm going to change this slightly. I'm going to tweak this slightly. Look how it is now. The ones on the top, the links on the top, have a white background and black text. The link in the footer has a green background and yellow text. Let's look at this. All right. The link in the nav, background of white, color black. All right, that's what it is. The link in the footer has a color of yellow. I didn't specify a background color. So why is the background color for that guy green? Because, again, it cascades down. That link is part of a footer, which is part of the body. Since I haven't defined any style rule of the background of the footer, it's part of the body, and therefore it gets the background from the body. So it cascades down. All right. What if I were to do this? If I change that to just an A, and I say A, background white, color black, footer A, color yellow, what would be the difference in how the page is going to look? Or would there be a difference? Okay, we have a vote for no difference. Okay, background white, text yellow. That's probably the two reasonable choices. Let's see which one we get. And we get the background is white and the text is yellow. Why is that? Well, let's look. Here we're saying every link on the page has a background of white and a color of black. All right. We then override the links for foot in the footer section to say it has a color of yellow. But we did not say anything about the background. So no longer does the color cascade down from the body, because that A is more specific than the body. it gets that one. So this can be a little tricky at times, and this is where a little bit of planning comes into play. Because you don't have to necessarily set every attribute on everything, all right? If you let the language work the way that it was intended to, you can write some pretty concise code. If you want to change something, you change one thing, and boom, that change takes effect. I'm going to go and put that back the way it was because I like that way better. All right. Here's the question I thought I heard before class. What if I wanted to show the page I was on a little bit different? Is that what you were asking about? In other words, I'm on page one now, yet the link for page one looks the same as the link for page two. How could I do that? Well, there's a new thing that we can do that's called an ID. All right? An ID is an additional kind of selector that you can have. All right? And we've used IDs before in this class when we've used internal links to make a link to a certain section of a page. We put an ID on it, and then we said ahref equals pound sign, whatever the value of the ID was. So an ID on a tag identifies that tag. It points to just one tag on the page. There should only be one thing on the page, one tag on the page, or one element, to use the precise term, that has a certain ID. So I can put an ID on something, and then I can write a style rule for it. So let me go in here. Let me open up both my pages and my CSS file. For ski, this guy's the current page, right? This guy's the page that we're on, ski.html. So I am going to put an ID on there that says ID equals current page. All right. I'm then going to go to my second HTML file. I'm going to get rid of that, by the way. And I'm going to put on the second link, ID equals current page. So I put on each of these the link to the page that I'm already on, I've given an ID of current page to. Now all I have to do in my style sheet is create a style for the ID of current page. And on the first page, the first link has an ID of current page. On the second page, the second link has an ID of current page. So, notice that for these HTML tags, I just type in the tag. I don't do anything like before it to designate, hey, this is an HTML tag. When I create a style rule for a ID, I put a pound sign, just like I do with the href. If you remember when we made those links, the IDs, we put a pound sign in front of it. And I can put current page. And then I can go and I can create a rule for that ID. All right? And just to do something different, I'm going to, instead of changing the color, because we want to expand our palette of things we can do, I'm going to make these links bigger. So I'm going to say font size 2M. What does 2M mean? M is short for the word emphasis. 2M simply means twice as big as it normally should be. So if I said 1M, that would be what it normally would be. If I said 0.5M, that would be half as big as it should be. So now, when I go and do this, and call up page 1, notice the link for page 1 is bigger. That would give the user a visual cue that, hey, you're on page 1. If I go to page 2, I'm guessing I forgot to save page 2. There you go. And page 2 has that bigger as well. You'll see that a lot on websites. I can't think of an example off the top of my head. But they'll do something special in their navigation to highlight, hey, you're on this page. All right? That's a nice thing to do just to sort of help keep the user, help keep it clear in the user's mind exactly what page they're on. All right? So you can do that with IDs. So, learning CSS consists of learning how to expand two different things. One of the different things that we're going to learn to expand is the selector. All right? And you remember the selector defines what on the page gets a particular rule. So we started out with just very basic selectors, like an HTML tag. Then every HTML tag that matched that on the page would get this rule. And then the whole cascading bit, so if something is part of several HTML tags, it gets the one most specific to it. We then expanded that to include that you can say HTML tags within a section. So header H1s look different than section H1s. Now we've added an ID. All right. We are soon going to add another thing called a class. And then there's all sorts of combinations and variations from there. So we're going to learn, essentially, the selector points to the things on the page that we want to change. So we're going to get better at pointing to specific things on the page that we want to change, instead of like we did the first week or so of class where we just, you know, said every tag on this page that was an H1 gets this rule. The other thing we're going to do is we're going to learn more about those style rules. Instead of changing the color, we're going to, like today, we changed the font size. We can change a lot about it. Almost every visual characteristic you can describe for an element, whether it be the font that we're using, the size of the font, whether it's bold, whether it's italics, all those things we can change via CSS. All right? Questions? Yeah. All tabs are just links that are styled. So that's one where we probably will talk about some things like that in class. But if you want to go beyond that, you know, there's a lot of good materials online, and I can help you out in lab. Other questions? All right. Yeah. Go ahead.
You're using these just as examples, but what would you actually do if you want to make it look good when you're on a specific page? Like, because obviously having double the size, I haven't seen many web pages actually do that. What is a good look?
A good look would be probably like a slightly different color. All right. A slightly different color. Or bold. Bolded might be. Or maybe a little bit bigger, not twice as big, but, you know, 1.1. size and all that. The more that we learn about the style rules that you can use, the more then you can decide. I mean, that's part of your job. The whole, you know, when we start talking about this, at this point we're really studying the techniques, the technical side of it. The design part of it is how do I use these things that I can do on a technical level to communicate so that instantly it's apparent, hey, the fact that that link is green and the rest of them are red, that means I'm on that page. You know, you can transmit, you know, people's brains are sharp, you know. They can easily, if you give them the proper visual cues, sort of figure out what you mean. And again, different color probably would be a good idea. Maybe a slightly different font or a bold font or italics. There's a lot of different ways that you can choose to represent that. But again, that's part of your job as a designer to figure out the best things to do. Other questions? Alrighty, see you up in lab.